Look here now. This is the
standing by.
Welcome to our sunset safari. Although, judging by the weather, I don't think we're going to be seeing any sunsets this afternoon. But for those of you joining us for the first time, welcome. My name is Jamie. I have Andrew on camera with me this afternoon, out and about on Jigger. Scott is around, along with Liam on camera. We also have the lovely Nikki and Kirsty and FC and Eugene doing all the technical things that need to happen to bring you a live safari. Don't forget, we are live, so we're coming to you right here and right now from Juma and Arethusa Game Reserves in the Sabi Sands in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa. And you never know what to expect around the next corner, as we keep saying, and I'm going to get back to that in a moment. But as you can hear, the wind is howling. It has been drizzling on and off all day. And naturally, we are rejoicing that particular fact, having been in this terrible drought as we have been over the last few months. It is wonderful to see rain, however light it may be. It is 24 degrees, so chilly. I'm wrapped up in a nice big jacket, which is about 76 degrees Fahrenheit, which may not sound chilly, but it is chilly after a couple of 40 degree days in a row. Right, now for those of you wondering why Brent is not out and about, having just come back from leave, I'm sure news by now has spread. I said you never know what to expect on a live safari. As it turns out, when you live out here, you never know what to expect as it is. Now, I'm not going to give you the full story. I feel as though that particular privilege belongs to Brent and VM himself, but Brent will be taking the afternoon off. He has a mild concussion, some cuts, scrapes and bruises, and an incredible story to tell when a female in Nyala that was being chased by those wild dogs that you saw this morning on the Sunrise Safari decided to jump into the car with them. That's all that I'm really going to tell you, except for the fact that they are both absolutely fine. The odd cut and bruise, but otherwise all okay. And we don't know what happened to the Nyala. They lifted it and helped it to exit the car, and she ran off. We don't know the end part of that story, because at that point, Liam and Brent were busy being administered a little bit of mild first aid. Just goes to show, you never know what to expect. I certainly didn't.
So Liam and I had probably one of the strangest experiences.
Very interesting stuff. And certainly I'm sure they're going to be dining out on it for a while. And Raisa, and I'm sure many others, you've all said you've just heard what happened and that you're glad they're okay. As you can imagine, we are too. Been tending to Brent this morning. He is a little bit cut up. Oh, that hole's getting big in the rain. Pulled a couple of grass shards out of his leg, but I'll leave the rest of the story for them to tell tomorrow. You'll have to wait for that particular privilege. I feel a bit like I'd be stealing their thunder otherwise. It definitely makes for a gripping tale. As it happens, back to the update from Kevin Catfish and from Peter. You saw the wild dogs on the Juma Dam camera shortly after the safari ended. As it happens, we saw them, or Brent and Liam, got a very close view of them shortly after that. So we're going to go and see if we can follow up on where those dogs have run off to. We will look left and right, though, repeatedly, quite possibly ready to duck. Shame that poor Nyala was wanting to get away, yes, and I mean, in that desperate situation, she would have been completely unaware of where she was going. I wish we could tell you more about the end part of that story, but she was still up and running the minute they managed to get her out of the window and away from the flailing hooves. And you were just also mentioning that you're glad the hyenas didn't jump into the car with us. Obviously, I assume you're referring to that hyena fight that Brian and myself experienced a couple of days ago. And yeah, absolutely, that's why I moved the car. I'm aware of the fact that when animals are feeling threatened or they are worried for their lives, they become very different creatures and very unpredictable. So at that point, I just moved the car to get us out, and myself and Brian, especially Brian, out of harm's way. Right, well, that's my update for the afternoon, and while I continue on my search around the Galago Pan for the wild dogs, let's pop over to Scott, who's found a mongoose to show you.
Well, as Jamie searches for a larger carnivore, the wild dogs, we've stumbled upon one of the smallest carnivores out here in Africa, and it's called a dwarf mongoose. It's posing quite perfectly, actually, and the other members of this colony aren't quite as brave as this individual. If I can just ask VM, who I'm teamed up with this afternoon, to zoom out a little bit. This individual is poking its head out of a hole that leads into an old termitarium, an old termite mound, and you'll see a few other little holes, quite a few actually, and there's a few members basically in all the other holes, and they keep poking their heads out temporarily, but not quite as brave and as bold as this individual. And this may be one of their homes. Oh, I spoke too soon. Oh no, he's still there. It's camouflage, I couldn't even see it. As I was saying though, this will be one of their homes, and they'll have several kind of homes within this area, some under fallen down logs, in other termite mounds, which means they'll have places to scurry to if there are any threats, any dangers, any birds of prey or any other predators that may want to try and catch them. They've got multiple places that they can scurry off to. And actually, when we came around the corner here, they all went barreling into their own holes. I'm sure they all are interconnected. And isn't that cute? Now, we're in a fairly similar area to Jamie, and my name is Scott. As I said, I'm teamed up with VM on camera, and we are also going to join in with the search for these wild dog with Jamie. Jamie for Scott. I just want to get a hold of her quickly and let her know about an update that I heard from Ephraim, who was the last guide with those wild dogs this morning, shortly after the collision with VM's vehicle and onto Brent's lap. And he said that they headed northeast away from the Juma waterhole into quite a big block. So I'm going to suggest that Jamie checks either Gowrie Cutline or Hyena Road, and I'll do the other one. Those two roads will allow us to check the last general area.
We're going to try and pull up with those in the Dutch.
Jamie, just to let you know, Ephraim said they headed northeast chasing impala from the dam. So exactly as I mentioned, there's two roads that we can check, and she's chosen Hyena Road. Okay, perfect. I'll do Gowrie Cutline, and I'm going to do Gowrie Cutline. So very important to make plans with one another, not only just Jamie and myself, but all the other guides in this area, because it's critical that we work as a team in order to be able to try and track down these animals. And there's a strong chance that Ephraim and or Andrew are also going to come in and start the search for these wild dogs with us. So good prospects for this afternoon. Again, and good to have you on board with us. And Gerard has quite aptly referred to those little dwarf dwarf mongooses as pocket rockets. And if you had have seen them exploding off away from the vehicle and down those little holes into the termite mound, you would certainly agree with Gerard. He is an ex-South African that's obviously spent a lot of time out in the bush and is now living in Saudi Arabia. So he may well have seen those little animals scurrying around a lot on previous safaris that he's been on. Ah, now, all of you guys thought that the drama after this morning's safari was going to be trying to remove the Mozambican spitting cobra that VM bumped into late last night as he opened the kitchen door. There was a Mozambican spitting cobra coiled up on the microwave, which is right at the entrance to a tiny, tiny kitchen. And VM said it reared up like a horse, which I think is a wonderful way to describe a cobra flaring its hood. And thankfully it didn't spit it in. They can spit about 2 meters fairly accurately. But VM said both he and the snake both got equal frights and probably both ended up going in the exact opposite directions to one another. So what VM did was he closed the door to the kitchen and he lay a trail of sand across the small little gap underneath the door. And the science behind that was that he would then be able to check in the morning if the snake had slithered out. And when we arrived there, there was no actually clear sign that the snake had left the building. So we put some signs on the door to make sure chef didn't go into the kitchen. And when we got back from drive, the plan was to collect some snake tongs, some long pole with a little clamp on the end that's specially designed for catching snakes, and Brent was going off to collect that with VM. So they were on the way to go and get the bits and pieces necessary to try and catch the snake, as well as some protective eyewear, and that's when the nyala jumped into the car. So shortly after we made sure Brent was okay and examined the damage to VM's car, we then headed into the kitchen and moved the two big fridges around, thinking that the snake may be coiled up in the warm working part behind there. No sign of it there. We checked in and around the oven. Also no sign of it in there. Basically, we made sure that it was not in that kitchen, which isn't too difficult because, like I said, it's a very, very small kitchen. And we don't know where it's gone, so we'll have to try and find another snake. And I know Cheesy Cheetah was hoping that we were going to find a snake for them today, but apologies, it eluded us. You're going to have to just wait until the next opportunity arises. Okay, well, after all this talk of nyala, I find it fitting that Jamie has found some for you to look at. See you later.
Here we go, and we have indeed come across a lovely herd of nyala. Brent's new best friend and cuddle companion, whether he wants it or not. And just to, as the little ones move behind, we can actually see how incredibly, I mean, I'm making light of it, it's actually not terribly funny. You can see with these little males behind the females, they're roughly the same size, but with spears on their heads. And I know that one aspect of the story was that the nyala did headbutt Brent in the face. So a question from VM. He wanted to know if any of these nyala have bandages on their heads. Not that I've seen. They all seem to be fine. Shame, that poor little female must have walked away from that with a bit of a headache, but she did walk away. She ran away, just to assure you all. These ones all look absolutely fine. They certainly don't look as though they've had an encounter with Brent Leo Smith and come off the winner. There's no one coming through, actually. I think this is our nyala herd that we've seen a few days in a row now. It's got one particular youthful individual that likes to canter around just for the fun of it, particularly on these nice, cool, cloudy, windy days. I've noticed since I began following that group of kudu that nyala and kudu tend to be seen in roughly the same area. I wouldn't say that it's absolutely 100% that it's the same group, but I do think that it's fairly certain. Don't those white dots look just like fingerprints? Now that I've been told that legend from Teresa about how nyala and kudu had legs too skinny to hold themselves up, and so the creator reached down and helped them up, and everywhere that the creator's hands touched them turned white. And ever since I've heard that, it's all I can see with those little fingerprint spots, particularly on the nyala. I love that story. I think that's one of my favorite that I've heard. Sandy, you were wondering, or you were saying that Brent has topped my adventures. Yes, absolutely he has. When we discussed this earlier, we were thinking about putting out a story that he went to beat up the silver cluster leaf to defend my honor after it really kindly landed me on my bottom in the middle of the road on the live show. But yes, I do believe that his... Brent has a way of doing that, doesn't he, Andrew? His stories tend to... Somehow it always happens to him. Hello, little one. You decide to make yourself shown. Our little ones are so cute. Nigel, you were asking if there are any pictures to show. There are indeed. I'm sure that Brent might be publishing them. I know he put a video up on Facebook. But I'm sure that if you are watching tomorrow's show, when he will tell you the full and gripping tale of his adventures with Viam and the nyala, that you will see some pictures. I will tell you that the loser of this entire incident was most definitely Viam's vehicle. But yes, somehow Brent's story, somehow it happens to him. We did phone Graham, by the way. Graham didn't quite know whether to believe us or not after it happened. Monty, it's fantastic to have you on this sunset safari. It's also so lovely watching the animals enjoy the cool weather and the new green shoots that have started to pop out now that we've had rain. But Monty, you were wondering what we would do if, for example, the water stopped flowing completely, if the dams dried up, and if the rivers, I assume as well, Monty, dried up. So the area that we're in is open up to close to 3 million hectares, and in that respect we are very, very fortunate, because the animals can move to where the rivers are flowing. And some of them are, particularly towards the southern end of Kruger. But you wanted to know whether we couldn't maybe fly some water in for them, or something similar along those lines. It's very, very difficult to do. The country itself is in the grips of a terrible drought. Juma has been pumping 2 water holes, sort of roughly every second day, in order to provide the animals around here with a little bit of access to water. It's a difficult one because even that kind of water supply is not infinite. If you understand, it's all got to come from the underground water sources. It's pumped up from underground. And that supply, unless we continue to get rain, is also has the potential. I'm not saying it will. I'm saying it has the potential to run out, at which point the animals will have to move on. But Monty, at that point, the limit of what we can do actually sort of stops, unfortunately. We would love to be able to provide them with more. And actually, what's going to be worse to see as well is the fact that if this drought continues the way it has, and the dams don't fill up, the worst part will be the fact that there won't be enough nutritional value. And we're not going to see the impact in the next 2 months. We're going to see the impact in the next 7 months or 8 months, when we get to the end of our normal dry season, where we don't get any rain whatsoever. And that's usually over the period of about April until about October that it's our dry season. That's the natural dry season that occurs here inevitably. We would love to. We would love to be able to ship water in. Unfortunately, it's just one of those sad aspects of the drought that we're in, that we're not going to be able to do much more than we already do. I'm just repositioning so we can get another view of these lovely nyala, since the little one is so sweet. I also want to just say, since we've discussed the drought a little bit and I had to answer Monty's question in a slightly negative way to say that there's a limit to what we can do, but just bear in mind that these animals and these ecosystems have suffered through climate conditions like this before, long before our influence got here, and will probably continue to survive it long afterwards. And with a huge area like this, it will recover fairly quickly. And the animals, some will die, but for the most part, the populations will spring back. Hello, little one. And sites like this, with the little nyala youngsters and that kudu youngster we had, are always a special way to just remind ourselves of the happiness that the bush has. And just to update you, Scott is checking all the way east along Biffleswick Dam. I'm going to make my way up Hyena Road, as promised, to see if we can spot where those wild dogs went. These nyala look very relaxed to me. And since we did discuss this tiny nyala that we had a brief view of, he's being very camera shy at the moment. Every time we try to look at it, it hops away. But a couple of days ago, we saw a brand newly born kudu calf that was probably only a couple of hours old. It was still damp and definitely still wobbly. And Cloud Sharon, you were wondering if anyone has seen it. Not as far as I know. It hasn't been mentioned to me. I was not out on drive this morning, but I didn't hear any reports of that little kudu calf. Hopefully long way away from the wild dogs. Sorry guys, I'm just going to listen to the Game Drive channel for a second. Helps I don't change the channel that I'm trying to listen to in an attempt to turn it up.
No, I was trying to hover in this corporation continue. You know that there are two tracks going towards in front of Galago there. Maybe if you can come in to that then. Just west of this busy car on the road. Okay, copy.
Alright, well, Scott's on his way towards an interesting sighting by the sounds of it. I'm not entirely sure what it is, and I'm not going to clog up the radio channel by asking. We will just have to wait and see what on earth is going on. I have no idea. Your guess is as good as mine. I'm gonna get this name right. Voodoo Blue. I think a new viewer on YouTube. You were wondering which part of Africa that we are in. Well, first of all, a big welcome to our live safaris. We hope that you will become as addicted as our regular viewers have become. And certainly as we are to ourselves to being out here. We are in Juma and Arethusa Game Reserves in the Sabi Sands, which is part of the Greater Kruger National Park areas. It's one of the largest. Hello, kudu. Speaking of, that is very convenient of you. Sorry, we are in the Greater Kruger area, one of the largest wilderness areas within South Africa. It's an area the size greater than certain small countries. So a wilderness area that's continued to, or stories have continued to play out here in a wilderness area that has continued without major influence from man for the last 100 or so years. And Purdue, if you can let us know where you're from, we always love to know where our viewers come from. it makes for an interesting, just an interesting experience to know that how far across the globe we are reaching. But also for our regular viewers, it's always nice to hear about other Safari Live fans that are across the globe. We have viewers from Finland, the States, all the way to Japan, New Zealand. Hello, girl. Sorry, I should probably actually just chat about this kudu briefly. She's also heavily pregnant. I don't think this is our new mother. Not as heavily pregnant, though, as some of the females that we've seen. Actually, the one on... Just... Oh, no, she's going to move off. Never mind. She's going to. But she is definitely, definitely very pregnant.
Have you still got audio, Jax?
I'm fairly certain that... This is the same group that we've been following. I wouldn't know, though, because it seems as though every corner I turn around, there seems to be a pregnant kudu. There's lots and lots of them about. We thought we'd try and make it a mission to get a live kudu birth on film. And in fact, Andrew and I filmed a live wildebeest birth not too long ago. And there's something so special about watching those events live. It's very touching.
And no more audio, eh?
Those graceful legs. Hello, little boy. Your horn's just starting to come through. And Purdue, if you have any questions that you'd like to ask, for example, and this applies for all the new viewers, if you have any questions that you'd like to ask about the wonderful animals that you are seeing, feel free to send them through to us. We love to hear from you. And for us, it's almost like having guests on the back. It's definitely like having guests on the back of a vehicle with us. So the way it works is essentially we drive along, or sometimes we find holes, and we have a cameraman on the back who shows you and brings you some of the most incredible images that you could see out here. For example, these gorgeous kudu. Hello, girl. All right, girl. And we did spend a considerable amount of time with the kudu around Juma, waiting to just see if there was any chance of them giving birth. She looks as though she might pop at any moment. She really does. I don't know if it's my imagination or if I can see angles sticking out there in her belly. And Mary, you really enjoyed that sighting that we had of that young, young kudu calf. And I agree with you, what made it so special for us was the fact that she was so accommodating and she felt comfortable enough within our presence to actually stand right in the road about 10 meters in front of us and let her brand new calf suckle. And whether or not that was from the amount of time we spent with them, just getting them used to the car, I actually think, well, it seems as though Scott has caught up with the wild dogs. I'm going to send you across there.
Hey, sorry, man. Welcome back, everyone. Tex is just laughing with us. He helped us greatly in finding this pack of wild dogs. He's one of the Juma guides, and he's been at the hyena den. And oh, look, they've got the remains of a kill. There's a skull in the one on the left mouth there. There we go. And as I was saying, Taxon was at the hyena den. He had just arrived, and then all of a sudden he heard some strange audio being made by these critters, and the hyena all went running off towards the pack, and we raced off into the area, and jackpot. The same individuals that are responsible for chasing the nyala into VM's car and onto Brent's lap this morning. And a fascinating fact has come through from Nikki's uncle, Phil. Hello, Phil. Great to know that you're watching. And Fuller's worked out that this time last year, an elephant crashed into one of the SafariLIVE vehicles. And quite crazy that exactly a year to date later, nyala has crashed into another one. So January the 16th, next year, we're all going to have to keep an eye out for anything jumping towards our vehicles. So, interesting stuff. This pack, in all likelihood, has very recently made this kill, unless it is remains from earlier in the day, but it's not likely. Usually, wild dog will kill and move away from a carcass. They won't stay with the carcass because they know that it could bring trouble, like lions or leopards or hyena. And who knows, the hyena are probably finishing off this carcass wherever the kill was made. The spinal column, the larger bones that the wild dog are not able to process as they lack the bone-crunching jaws of the hyena. This is so awesome, and what an incredibly lucky way to start the afternoon. I just need to keep everyone updated. Okay. The pack on our mobile towards the drainage line away from onto the northern side of the camp.
I'm having the mobile to the place where you saw me earlier on.
Tex, in that drainage that hugs the lodge, the northern side of the lodge, down towards the dam.
Ah, okay.
Okay, so excuse me, but I am going to have to be on the radio just to make sure we keep everyone updated and get them into this sighting as quickly as possible. Why has this pup come running up here? Have they already found another animal to chase? It's possible that they have. It could have just been chasing a Franklin. That's the bird that we heard alarm calling there. Looking a little bit bemused, but hard to see them down in the riverbed, and I just want to get down into here where we're going to probably get some better views. Well, even though they have just caught and killed, there's a lot of wild dogs in this pack, 3 adults and 11 pups. And what that means is that we can expect them. Oh, this is going to be awesome. Some great low angles. We should get them through this little gap here. Oh, wonderful. And they're probably all going to come trotting down past the side of the car here eventually. As I was saying though, 3 adults, 11 youngsters, and look at their big ears.
Spot for Jamie.
There you go. Hey, Jamie.
Scotty, just switching now. I'm going to make my way into the area just to be on standby if you need help relocating them. I won't join the sighting unless you need me.
Very good. Sounds like a good plan. And even if you look at their bellies now, they're not extremely full.
I'm also trying to get around towards your side there.
Copy that, Tex. They are not on the road heading towards, or they're heading up towards Mvubu now. Look at the one carrying a little snack along with it. The leg of an impala, it looks like. I think that looks like a young impala that they've caught. Chaos of following wild dogs has begun. So fasten your seatbelts and enjoy the ride. If this is your first SafariLIVE adventure, you must understand that this is happening right now in Africa, and it's a huge privilege for every single one of us to be following them. They're highly endangered and also highly effective hunters. Absolutely spoilt with their first drive. Yeah. Perdu, welcome on board. And It's not often that we get off to such a good start. It really isn't.
Okay.
Sharon in Pittsburgh has noticed that when we chat on the radio, we use their Shangaan or Tsonga name, which is the local language of this area. And the reason for that is that before the day of an age of earpieces, all the radios used to be open, as ours is now. And look at them. This is awesome. There'll be a lot of competition and hierarchical battles already between these young pups. And that's still just the skull, I think, in the mouth of one of those individuals. It looks like a big chunk of meat, but I think it's just the skull or the remains thereof. Sorry, Sharon. But the reason why is that the guides would like to keep the elements of surprise for their guests, and that's why they use the local Shangaan names. And also to prevent guests nagging you to race to every sighting that gets called in. That's the other also kind of behind the scenes answer to your question. If guests knew everything that was getting called in on the radio, they would expect you to race from every end of the property to the other, which makes it difficult to conduct a well-worked safari experience. So those are two of the reasons. And here they are. It is the legs of a young impala, it looks like. The pack are now heading northeast through the block from Mvubu Gallagher Link Junction. Okay. This is going to be interesting. Copy that text. I'll keep you updated. I've literally gone north straight from that junction. Yeah, at this stage, maybe head up towards the fire break and I'll try and stay with them until they get there. Okay, now as we're off-road, you need to understand that we may drive over certain trees, but we know those ones are going to pop back up. Maybe not immediately, but in sometimes a couple of days. And essentially, we're not causing major damage to them. Certain trees, the slower growing trees, we will avoid at all costs because those are less flexible. Now, Jamie's just double checking what she thinks she should do, and I think probably the best bet at this stage would be heading to the hyena den, which was her initial plans. It's going to be difficult for her to assist us in this area because there's not many roads between where we are and where these animals are going. So for now, I think she can carry on as planned, although these animals do change direction, and as I say, that they're heading more east than north at the moment, so maybe she can just hang around at the dam or in that general area of the dam just for a short while in case they don't chase something back in that direction. So that'll probably be better just for a couple of minutes before they change direction again. They're heading more east now, so maybe head along Gari Katlan that way.
Okay, copy that. Thanks. On that Kyrgyzstan from the initial jam, we'll go on Gari Katlan.
Isn't that wonderful, that high-pitched chattering? One young pup's trying to steal some scraps from another. Again, I think it's just a very small piece of remains. Donna, you are absolutely correct. These dogs are looking incredibly healthy. They're in great form. And the pups are growing quite quickly. It's soon going to be very difficult to distinguish between adults and pup. And what I've said once, and I keep saying, and even Brent was also saying this morning, drive is that the fact that they've managed to still keep 11 pups is phenomenal, especially for this area where wild dog typically don't have the best record in terms of raising pups. And it's not their fault, it's that they live in a dangerous area. There's a lot of lion, leopard and hyena here, and that's what is the cause for a lot of wild dog pups to be killed. We're probably directly north of Gowrie Dam now, heading in an easterly direction. The next road that we could come up to would be Gowrie Cutline, but it's probably about half a mile away from us to the east. And we've got Buffalo's of Cutline to our north, and probably equidistant to there. And that's why I said it's going to be tricky for Jamie to assist this stage, but we're lucky they've chosen a very open pathway for us to follow them through for now. But I know where we're going is getting considerably thicker. I remember racing after the Inkahuma Pride, which is a pride of lion we used to see very regularly here at Juma. They're not too far away at the moment, I don't think. I think they're just a little bit east of us, or they were yesterday. Anyway, they were chasing a large herd of buffalo, and we had to just follow a plume of dust up ahead of us, but we couldn't keep up with them, and we missed all the major action of that chase. Uh-oh, here's some elephants. So this we need to be careful of, because if the elephants catch wind of these wild dogs, which they will, and they probably already have, the wind is blowing towards this elephant, and you can see it's got its tail held out. A very good indicator that it's not happy. And they can't see the wild dogs, but they clearly are not happy. Head up high. And this is great body language. Here go the pups chasing after them. They couldn't resist. Look at all of them. Here they go. Too good to be true. There go the ellies. And I'm going to just try and reposition ever so slightly. See if we can't get any slightly better views. Wasn't that incredible? One of the giants of the African wilderness giving way to these tiny little wild dogs. And some of you will remember an incredible sighting of wild dogs being chased around by elephants and vice versa with Brent not too long ago. Not sure if it was the same pack. Could well have been. So two of the Magnificent Seven in one sighting. That's a real bonus. The wild dog and the cheetah have been added on to the Big Five to make the Magnificent Seven. And another wonderful observation has just been made by Country West. And even when these dogs aren't in a hurry, they are moving very quickly. And that's what makes it so much fun following them. Even when they're not in a rush, we have to rush to keep up with them. They're currently heading straight east now. Probably going to pop out midway along Gowrie Cutline at this stage. As you can see, my roots are becoming a lot more windy now, and not as easy as it was initially, but we knew what we were getting into here, so at least I was kind of mentally prepared for this. If this was my first drive here at Juma, I would be in not nearly as a fortunate position as now, after having spent a bit more time in this area. Have you got them, Ben? Straight in front. Okay, just double check. And happy to hear that Jamie's standing by on Gari Cutland, so I'm sure she's going to be able to find them soon. They're not too far from the Cutland now. If you switch off, you should get my audio. So I just gave a little bit of an extra rev there just to give them a bearing of where we are. And by them, I mean Jamie and Taxon. They have looped around. I can see the road, they're on the road now, so Jamie should have them, somebody should have them. Okay, we'll be out shortly though.
No problem.
That was some serious bundu bashing, as we've termed it. And even though you may have got a glimpse of Jamie there, the reason why Nikki in Final Control couldn't cut to her, sadly she doesn't have any signal. But what a pleasure, at least she can just sit back and enjoy this sighting now. Look at that big chunk missing out of the ear there. And VM's doing a great job showing you the full anatomy of these individuals. This could be the alpha male, I'm not entirely sure. It's two males and one female, I believe, that are adults in this pack. And wasn't that fun racing through the bush after them? I wonder what they're going to do next. To Christine, who would like to know when next will the wild dogs give birth to some pups, and it'll be in May next year. They, in this part of Africa, they will den usually in the month of May every year. It may vary ever so slightly from pack to pack, and I believe this year they were actually a bit late, if my memory serves me correctly. There's Jamie and Andrew, and as you can see, she's focused on enjoying the pack and didn't notice me waving at her. And we're going to send you across to a vehicle. Their signal seems to have stabilized, and now you'll get a different perspective.
How awesome is this? So Andrew and myself, we had a chance to join the sighting. We won't be able to stay here for too long, just because fact that there are other vehicles wanting to approach. So we only need to have two of us here, where one will do. What are you munching? That looks like a hoof. Yeah, definitely a hoof. Makes a perfect chew toy for a wild dog. And when we came through here, they were behind a very terrified impala that managed a lucky escape into the drainage line. I think the fact that they've clearly just eaten means that they're not putting too much effort into chasing behind it, but you can just get a rough idea of how the sighting is laid out. We have been so lucky with these wild dogs recently. They have been incredibly obliging. Apart from their timing with Nyala. But other than that, it is wonderful to see this investing pack, and fantastic that the adults, the only three of them, have done such a sterling job in managing to keep 11 pups alive and well in the way that they have. There's so many different threats out here to the wild dog population. Now, when I do have to pull out of the sighting, I'm actually going to make my way across to the hyena den, just because, as many of you know, these two top predators vie for dominance, sort of falling between second and third in the predator hierarchy. There you can see where Scott is, watching a dog wag its tail at him. And having a brief look at him and Viam. And the rest of them settling down. This is the wonderful thing about this weather, is the fact that they are on the move. So, Let me just try and get an idea of how many we've got here. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. We should have 14, as to the best of my knowledge. Should be 11 pups and 3 adults. I can only count 12. That's not necessarily any kind of reason to panic. It could well be that they're just lying slightly out of where I can see them. There are times in these sightings where they seem so similar to the domestic dogs that we know and love. But they've definitely had, clearly, as evidenced by, first of all, being covered in blood, but also the fact that one was chewing on a hoof suggests to me that they've killed something fairly recently. But that's also why I want to go to the hyena den, just because apparently what alerted everybody to the sighting was the fact that they could hear hyena calls. And I think that the presence of the wild dogs in this area, close to where hyena calls were, is a little bit too much of a coincidence. Look at that. It's such awesome, playful behavior. A typical wild dog approach. Oh, I'm playing dead. I'm dead. I've rolled over. You win. I'm too full. I can't handle this. It's wonderful to watch them play. And what we saw there was that typical wild dog slight stalk approach. With their head down, their ears flat down their back. Creeping in. Now, I think I've actually counted 13 now that I've done a recount. I'm just trying to. It's kind of difficult because sometimes there's more than one lying down right next to the other, which always creates a little bit of confusion. But I think I see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Awesome. And they've moved much closer to where Scott is. So I think let's pop over to that side and see things from his perspective.
Welcome back, everyone. And I believe you've been sniping me with the super zoom from Jamie's vehicle, myself and VM. We are looking perplexed and bemused, as we usually are. Now, this male that you're looking at, you can see he's looking intently back in the direction that we've come from. And that's because it looks like one of the adults is missing. It could be a pup that's missing, but there's one animal short. I'm not sure if Jamie gave you her head counts of 13, but it's the same as mine. And it's interesting that all the other kind of dogs, the pups, were not too concerned about anything. They were just lazing about and playing around. But the two adults, a male and a female, were the two that made me realize that something was kind of amiss, because they were looking back very intently in the direction we've come from, as I've said. So what often happens, it's not uncommon for wild dogs to split up, and the adult may have, oh. Just want to listen carefully. You may have heard a contact call from the other wild dog. There's Taxon and Fanwell and his guests to help get us into the right position. He's giving us a little thumbs up there saying no problem. So he's the man who got us into the right position at the right time, so a big thank you to him and his tracker Fanwell, a great team. Now what's interesting is they've got a number of different vocalizations, wild dog. They've got a kind of dog-like bark almost that is an almost echoing sound to it, a very deep bark that they will let off usually if they get a fright. And the only time I've seen it is when they've been startled by lion or come across lion, and or when they get startled by something at their den site. So that's the major time, the most often, the cause for them to let out their bark when they get a fright or they're panicked. They've also got the high-pitched chattering that they'll communicate amongst one another with in close quarters, which we've seen a little bit of already this afternoon. And then there's also a very strange whooping howl, almost kind of like an ambulance. Wow, wow, wow. Matt, though, little, that's probably not the best impersonation of the noise, but I can't quite get it down to tune. To be honest, I actually haven't heard it that many times. But that's the kind of audio that we'd expect to hear for pack members that are trying to relocate one another over large distances. Well, hello to Bongo Scott. I like your name. And what a pleasure it is to welcome you to the Safari Live family. It's Bongo Scott's first drive, and he loved the thrill of that first chase. And I'm glad we've set the tempo high for you, Bongo Scott. We are really, really fortunate to be with these animals now. And even though all kind of everything's calmed down and everything's peaceful, just like this, they can get up again and start moving quickly straight back into the hunts on the move. And that's why I'd suggest not going anywhere until these animals disappear. And even if they do, we don't know what we may bump into around the next corner. The great thing about them is that they could actually lead us to leopard. Often these animals will chase leopard up trees, steal their kills from them. So they're very, very formidable. And we've got a good afternoon lined up, so don't move a muscle. To Romy in Ohio, and you're interested to know whether all 11 pups are from one litter, from one mother, and I think that they are. I'm fairly confident that they are. Because both of the packs that we've seen this year, this is called the Investec pack, and we've also seen a pack called the Sabi Sands pack, which is slightly larger. It's got about 10 or 11 adults and about 9 pups, I think. I'm not sure what the current numbers are, but that was the kind of figures last time we saw them. And one of the two packs, I think one of the alpha females did die after giving birth, but interestingly, wild dogs will help raise pups that were not necessarily mothered by themselves, so unlike hyena, who will only raise their own cubs. So I think some pups may have been adopted in one of the two packs, and I'm not sure if it is this one, but what I can assure you is that it's possible for wild dogs to give birth to over 20 pups in one litter, one individual. So they have the ability to give birth to massive, massive litters of pups, even though that's not entirely common. They often are around the 10 to 14 figure mark. Anywhere upwards of that, I guess, is a rarity, but still possible. And Nikki's just mentioned to me, imagine giving birth to 20, that's just crazy. And it is. It's a remarkable figure, especially when you compare them to all the other large predators of this area. Let me reposition slightly. I'm not leaving VM much of an angle here to show you the rest of the pack. Shell and Detroit's interested to know whether or not they will act like wolves with regards to their communication and all be howling in unison. And not as far as I've seen, but that whooping kind of ambulance noise that I've only heard them and seen them make a handful of times, I guess could be associated to it to a degree, but it's not a commonly made noise, at least not that I've seen. And I wouldn't attribute it to be like that of the wolves. That must be something else, to hear a whole pack of wolves howling. And who knows, maybe one day we'll be going on a live safari through Yellowstone National Park, where I'm told the wolf population is now flourishing and it's having great ripple effects on the whole ecosystem in that area.
Hello to Billy Belenji. Haven't heard your name before, so welcome. And Billy Belenji would like to know, when will these pups start mating? And will their pups stay a part of this pack? Now, it's difficult to tell Billy Belenji exactly what will happen. There's no set hard and fast rule with wild dogs. What often happens with them is that members of a pack, often a couple of males and maybe even a female, so mixed sexes, will split off from a pack if it gets too big, and those are called dispersal packs. So you may get two or three kind of teenagers running around, and they might bump into another group of two or three teenagers, have a bit of a boxing match, and then kiss and make up afterwards, and then start a pack of their own. But that probably will only start happening from a year and a half to 2 years of age. Here's something quite cool that's happening to the right of us, Fionn. And I just want to make sure I know what's going on, but I think it could be that there's an African hawk eagles taking their chick for a flight. There were three of them. And the African hawk eagles have been nesting for quite some time in a tree off Central Road, and the fact that we just saw all three of them flying past means that that could be a successfully raised fledgling that's now learning the ropes of how to fly and where to go and how to hunt. So that was pretty awesome. I don't know how many of them you managed to see there. I wasn't looking at the monitor. I was trying to get a binocular view of that third and final one, but it did look like it was another one. So, good stuff. Those are the African hawk eagles. Hello to Cecilia, and you've just raised a very good point, also on the topic of the pups, and how much longer will we call them pups for? And, I don't know the hard and fast rule to this, but I think fairly soon we should actually, even from now, we should start calling them sub-adults, not necessarily pups. But maybe that's only when they start actively contributing towards the hunting, so maybe in another month or two. But I don't know the hard and fast rules. It'll be interesting if anyone does know a hard and fast rule to that, because it'd be wonderful if you could provide us with that interesting information. Jamie's just arrived at the hyena den, and she would just like to show you what's going on there.
I've left Scott with the wild dogs because I wanted to just come and investigate what was happening with the hyenas. And just to clarify, originally Scott found the wild dogs because one of the other guides called in sounds of hyena calling. Where Scott found the wild dogs is very, very close to the hyena den at the moment. So this active hyena den at Vuvu Road. I wanted to come and investigate and see whether there was any sign of the hyenas or whether in fact they were involved in a conflict between or with the wild dogs. It does happen. We know this. Some of you may have been watching that sighting with Scott where the wild dogs managed to corner a hyena. Its friend escaped and dashed off, and they cornered and attacked one of the lone members of this clan. And I was just wondering whether the hyenas might have become particularly defensive due to the sort of close proximity of the clan to this hyena den. So I came to investigate. All is quiet now. I'm going to go and investigate back towards Galago Pan and some of the trickier hyena paths that I know of. I know the ways that they move around this area now. I might even go back and check the den at Galago Shortcut. It's all close to the same area. And let's see if we can't investigate and discover whether or not anything did actually happen between the hyenas and the wild dogs this afternoon, because I personally wouldn't be surprised if it did. So I'm going to head out, go and investigate and see what I can see. In the meantime, Scott is still with the wild dogs, so let's pop over there.
this is an adult male, and he's just been pricking his head up again, looking again longingly in the direction we've come from. Here he goes again. And they've got incredibly intimate bonds, these animals. And that's probably why they're missing the extra pack member. So, a couple of good questions coming through regarding the missing pack member. The first one from my good friend Matty, just 9 years old, all the way in Ohio. Hi, Matty, and hope all is well with you. Matty, I'm not too sure if these two will actually go back and look for the missing member. Like I said earlier, they might use that loud whooping, ooh, 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 kind of noise. The way I make it is probably nothing like the way they make it, but that's the kind of noise that they'll make when they're trying to get a hold of other wild dogs that are far away. But they don't do it that often, and they, I guess, rely on one another's or senses of smell and hearing to try and relocate one another. So I don't think they're going to go back and look for it. But Sherry's brought up a good point, and that is that maybe that is why they've stopped here. They don't want to go too far away from their friend, and hoping that if they stay here not too far away, he should be able to find them again. So I think that's the way it's going to work out. And good point there, Sherry. I'm just going to ask VM to pan across to Bird of Prey. It just flew directly over them, and not going to be easy. Sorry, VM, I've thrown you in the deep end. He's shooting between the antenna ropes, but he made it look easier than it actually is. And then you can see the battalion sawing off. What's interesting is that it did fly directly over them, and it almost hovered here for a second, just making sure that they didn't have a kill here. In some areas of Africa, you can be lucky enough to actually follow various types of raptors as they follow packs of wild dog, knowing, because they are one of the most successful predators, that they are going to make a kill soon, and that's why it's going to be worth animals or birds like the kites, some of the tawny eagles, steppe eagles. The eagles that like feeding on carcasses will actually follow packs of wild dogs. And imagine driving around and seeing about four or five eagles flying in an area, and then you know that's the area to go and look for the wild dogs. It must be great, great fun. It's happened once here where I had one or two eagles, I can't remember what they were, following the pack. So that's something to think about. And again, maybe if we end up in another safari destination one day, we'll get to see such a wonderful thing happening. But for now, we can enjoy the wonders of the Sabi Sands. And I know I have been harping on a lot about different parts of Africa, but it's important not to forget that we are incredibly lucky to be in this area. I've been to many different wilderness destinations in Africa, and this certainly is one of the most productive in terms of high-profile game and high-action safaris. So definitely worth remembering if you are planning a safari, that each destination will be different to another. So we're currently looking at all of the pups, and let's try and count them. It's not going to be easy. I'm going to try and plonk my finger into the screen, but there's one, two, a third one at the back, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. I'm missing one, but I think they could just all be jammed up together. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. Looks like just 10 to me, but maybe it's just because they're blanketed over one another. And that's where all the pups are lying. And Terry in New York is just like to know, where are the adults? And no different to most normal scenarios, the adults have distanced themselves from the rest of the pack, and they are lying up huddled next to one another here. And that's fairly often the case with wild dog. The adults will lie away, sometimes up to 50 or 100 meters away, and you can see they
are definitely best friends, possibly the alpha male and alpha female, but I cannot be 100% sure of that. We would have needed to have seen them during the mating season, during May, to be sure of that. But I guess just from general behavior, you could deduce it, but we haven't, or I haven't at least spent enough time to be certain with this pack. And very happy to hear that one of our viewers, first viewers, I think, from Romania, who joined us just yesterday, has joined us again this afternoon. And Luca, good to know you are back on safari. And aren't you lucky you got the hyena you hoped for yesterday? And now wild dog today. So, like I just said, they do have an alpha male and an alpha female, which is a question you've asked. There's also a chance that there will be a beta female. So there is a possibility that from time to time, both pairs of young will give birth. Both females will give birth. I've been distracted by a vehicle that's just arriving here, and I thought it was somebody that I knew, so I lost my words for a moment, but on closer inspection it's not. But happy that some more people are joining us in this wonderful sighting. Also, it's important to remember and take note of the fact that we've already had Taxon in the sighting with us. He only spent about 15 or 20 minutes. Then Andrew from Cheetah Plains joined us, and now a third vehicle is joining us. And quite often people who are on short safaris or shorter term safaris, who are only here for 3 or 4 nights, will only actually spend short periods of time with these animals. And that again just emphasizes how lucky we are to be able to invest so much time with them, because you guys can join us for safaris daily, unlike most people who only come here for kind of 3 or 4 nights. We are fortunate that we can spend long periods of time with these animals. So, not only that, we also have Jamie out scouting for other action. So you mustn't feel let down if the kind of service you get if you do come out on safari is different to the experience that we give you, because it is, like I said, slightly different in a number of ways. If you could hear this high-pitched chattering, this one pup got a few of the others a bit riled up. But once they get going a little bit later, and I'm sure they will, then we're going to get the real show. Bill Burkett, good question. You would like to know if these animals hunt at night, and typically no, they don't. And interestingly, it's the wild dog and the cheetah that are not known for being nocturnal hunters. They are more diurnal, and it's fairly uncommon to see them moving at night. And actually, if we do follow them up until dark, unlike lion and leopard, we won't continue to follow them with a spotlight for that very reason. They're not nocturnal animals. They're not designed for movement at night. And even though they can move in the dark, as will cheetah, also in the early hours of the morning, they might get up and going well before sunrise. It's typically frowned upon to follow them with spotlights. So that's also something that's worth preparing yourself for if we are lucky enough to stay with them, until dark tonight. Although we aren't closing in the dark at the moment, so time is on our side, and so is the time of the setting sun. Thank you very much for counting the correct number of pups, and you have in fact counted 11. I'm not sure where I was going wrong, but I'm glad somebody at least solved that puzzle, so thank you for confirming that. There's apparently 6 in that carpet of wild dogs that we're looking at now, and another 5 dotted out to the left. One
Won't it be wonderful if we get to see the missing adult return and reunite, because that'll certainly create a commotion and a stir, as we can expect to see even if it doesn't arrive, but when this pack starts to get up a little bit later. They've got this ritualistic ceremony of greeting, high-pitched chattering, lots of kissing and mouthing one another as they run around and play kind of in a frantic frenzy, and then eventually the adults will head off and the rest of the pack will start following behind, and then we'll be exposed to a similar kind of adventure that we experienced as they left the waterhole a little bit earlier. Again, interesting that they've not only moved quite a far distance from the kill that they've made, but like I said, that's not uncommon for them. A lot of you may be thinking, well, why did they move so kind of quickly with so much purpose and then all of a sudden just plop down? And I think it was just to get some distance between them and the danger zone of that carcass or the remains thereof. I wonder if the hyena got anything. Okay, well, it looks like that one pup has just enticed another pup to get up, and let's just see what happens here. I'm sure a lot of you are wondering about what may have happened to that other adult. Did it get caught in the crossfire with the hyena that came running in? And I know Lisa was interested in that. I don't think it was, Lisa. And Loyalty thought that maybe in that encounter with the elephants, the adult may have got lost. And again, I don't think so. It wasn't very frantic. I think in all likelihood, as they were moving about, actually, as we kind of left the waterhole, remember I said there was, it seemed like there was, they had been chasing something, and there was that Franklin alarm calling nearby. Maybe the one adult darted off then and chased some prey a fair distance. Obviously, they can move very, very quickly. So if it had a bombshelled in one direction without the rest of the pack seeing and following suits, it could still be trying to work out where these guys are. So I think that's the most likely cause. A pack of wild dog, even though they are smaller individually than hyena, collectively, they can give hyena an exceptionally hard time. And a couple of months ago, we saw, I'm not sure what pack it was. I think it was... No, it was the other pack. It was the Sabi Sands pack. So more adults in that pack than this pack. But they really gave a hyena a run for its life. So here I'm not too sure what could have happened, but I don't think that adult dog would have got strung up by a hyena. Lion, yes, maybe. Leopard, yes, maybe. But hyena would be more prone to attacking the pups, I think. Just raised another good point, and she's suggesting that possibly the wild dog are looking back in the direction that we came from because the hyena were there and that interaction with the hyena. So definitely that's a very good theory. And on top of that, Sherry would like to know if I think that this pack would respond to any distress calls from the missing pack member if it were caught up and it let out a distress call trying to call these guys back. I think they definitely would run back in search of their friend, and they would definitely do everything possible to help them. They've got incredible bonds, like I said a bit earlier. So some of the pups are peeling off down into the riverbed, but I'm sure they're not going to go too far. Romy, another good point that I haven't touched on, and that is the beauty of being on drive with all of you guys. Thank you for all of your contributions. And if any of you are new to it and would like to also contribute with your thoughts and comments and questions, hashtag SafariLIVE on Twitter or send an email through to questions@wildearth.tv. Now, Romy's just asked if the wild dog that is missing may be enjoying a meal by itself. And very good point. It very could well be having a snack on its own, is eating as much of a kill that it can possibly squeeze into its stomach. And what will happen is it'll run back here and, interestingly enough, be able to regurgitate some of the meat for the other members of the pack. And again, that emphasizes just how sharing and caring these animals are for other pack members. What will also happen, even it's the same thing when the pups are very young, one adult, sometimes even two, will be left behind at the den site to guard and babysit the pups while the rest of the pack go out hunting. And when the adults return, not only do they regurgitate meat for the little pups, and all of the different adults will regurgitate meat for all the different little pups. Oh, here we got some action here. Look at them. This is the way they'll stalk up to prey. Ears flat, and they just ambushed their friends. Let's see if we get this high-pitched chattering here. Here we go. This is the jumping around, the mouthing, the frantic frenzy. But it's interesting that it's just the pups doing it. They may come and try and include the adults in this playful banter and urge them to go and try and find another meal. But let's wait and see. The adults need to condone an official greeting ceremony, but they're not interested at the moment and are lying flat in the grass as if nothing's actually happening. Look at how wonderful this is. They've got very, very razor sharp teeth, and you'll notice that as they mouth one another. It's absolutely remarkable how quickly they can tear apart a carcass, and an adult's impala will be torn apart in just minutes by this pack. I know Jamie lost visual of them for about 10 minutes as they chased off after impala, and 10 minutes later, once she found them, it was just a skull and a hoof left behind in just 10 minutes, and that's a lot of meat. That's not nearly as tender as the meat that we eat. It hasn't been hung up to age and mature. It's fresh off the bone, but those teeth did a great job tearing through it. That one does not look comfortable, the one underneath. The one on top is definitely winning this little wrestling match. And all very useful behavior. Even though they are playing, it's getting their agility and muscle memory honed for possible altercations with other packs in the future, altercations with other animals like hyena. Jim Butler, and you'd like to know how these guys deal with parasites and keeping clean, because you've noticed that red tinge on their coat from their most recent kill. And I guess they will groom one another to a degree, but they are capable of grooming themselves mainly. And I guess their rough and rugged lifestyle means just running through the bush will mean that they get to chase off. Look at these dogs running around all the vehicles, playing around as if we're not even here. And that's important to remember, that we are so fortunate to be able to enjoy these animals without interfering with their daily lives. And they are jumping around all over the show now. The ones on the right, VM, are also putting up a good show, just to let you know there's so much going on. I want to give VM as much intel as possible, because he's obviously just focused on the ones he's filming. But it can be quite a confusing scenario to be in when all of them start playing around like this. You don't know where to watch or where to film. I'm also going to ask VM just to quickly show the adults to give you an idea what they think of this. This is what the adults are up to. So that gives you an idea of their frame of mind. And here come the pups playing around in the background.
to Nora, who is in Munich, and you would like to know how old can they live to in the wild. I'm not too sure off the top of my head, actually, Nora, but I'm guessing not much older than 10 to 12 years of age, I think, would be a healthy lifespan for an adult wild dog. A lot will depend on the area that they're in, as it so often does with a lot of the African animals, because you may find wild dogs stretching from here all the way up to equatorial Africa, all the way up to Kenya and Tanzania. Their behavior can often be quite different in the various areas, as is the same for lion and hyena and leopard. But if anybody wants to confirm that age for me, a lifespan in the wild, or possibly the lifespans of various areas in the wild, I would greatly appreciate that, as would Nora in Munich. I think I'm going to pull out my camera because this is just too good to be true and try and fire off some snaps, as I would suggest for you too. Now, if you guys aren't familiar with how to take screenshots on your various devices that you may be watching on, I would suggest working out how to, because it's a great way to document your safaris. And it's good fun. I've seen a lot of you are great at the post-production and also enjoy editing the photos, which is a lot of the fun as well. A lot of your artistic flair can come through not only while taking the photo, but after you've taken the photo. Well, I don't want to get in your way though, so I need to be careful of that. To James Bear, who's interested to know if the recent rains that we've been having has helped wash the very pungent smell of the wild dogs off their coats, and it hasn't. They still have that very pungent smelling odor, which smells like that of a wet blanket, just like a regular dog blanket that's just been not washed for very long and in the rain for quite a while. Maybe you could throw in a little bit of cheese, a bit of cheesiness into the mix there, a bit of off cheese, but they certainly are very pungent. It's quite a sweet smell, but it's not as bad as I'm making it sound, so I need to be careful about that. But it really is very pungent, and you can't mistake it for anything else. Yeah, and as Nikki's just mentioned, you'd think they'd be tired by now, but they are endurance animals, and like most young creatures, full of beans. Ricky in Idaho, and it's an absolute pleasure staying with the wild dogs. They are such wonderful animals, and we don't get to see them very often. Now, Bram in the Netherlands, another name that I don't recognize, would like to know, why is it that they are such a highly endangered species? And there's a couple of reasons. I think personally the major factor is that canine-born rabies is a deadly killer of these guys, and it'll wipe out a whole pack at a time. Because they're such socially interactive animals, as you're seeing right now, with lots of mouthing and kissing. Oh, that one's getting bullied. That's for certain. And there'll be a lot of that going on. Shame. But like I said, hierarchies and positions of hierarchy are already being established between these young pups. So as I said, canine rabies is going to be one of the major killers of these animals, as well as habitat destruction. Like a lot of wild animals, loss of habitat, especially an animal that needs huge, huge areas to roam, like the wild dog. They're not bound to territories and have massive, massive home ranges that can stretch for many, many miles. And therefore, some animals can be kept safely in a small fenced reserve that's not open to huge areas, but wild dog wouldn't be able to do that. Oh no, that one's really in trouble at the moment. It's getting bullied from all angles. Some are on its tail, some are on its ears. And it's doing the best thing it can possibly do now, is lying down and play and submitting. And Gracie's just asked, do they hurt one another when they're playing rough? And Gracie, as you've heard, the one did just let off a yelp, so I think they do hurt one another, but not too much. But as you heard, that little yelp there, the one did get nipped a little bit harder than it would have liked to be. Oh, they're chewing on its tail now. Oh, it's getting a real hard time. But I don't think we have to be too worried, and I'm sure it's gonna just grow up to be very tough and strong after being treated like this, and it's gonna probably teach them a lesson or two once it's fully grown and maybe is a little bit wiser than them. So I think there's a lesson to be learned here, that even though it's getting a hard time now, it's gonna make it that much tougher for when it's older, which is not a bad situation to be in. Okay, hold on a second. I've just looked around and I've noticed that I think one of the adults has moved off down there. Well, there's two. But I think, I'm not sure if both are the adults, but I think it might be time for us to start moving. Well, has the other adult come back? I think those are two adults and the other adult may have joined. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. No. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. No, it's just one of the pups following. Oh, no, no. Here's the other pup here. So it is the other adults rejoined. Wonderful. We sadly missed it, but it joined, and immediately now the males decided to head off with the other male. Awesome. Dip down onto the road and maybe Vim will be able to film them running alongside us just for a second, because the road is quite smooth. There we go. Going over a little bump here. Oh, there we go. So now they've dropped down into the riverbed. It's very thick, but what I'm gonna, oh, what to do here. Jackalberry's far from here. VM suggested going to the Jackalberry, and then, which is a big tree up ahead of us. I'll show it to you. I mean, it's quite far away from where we are now. I don't even think we can see it from here. So it's somewhere, you know, we can't even see it from here. So we're much closer to Buffalo's pup line, and I'm guessing that's the direction we are going to need to head in order to try and relocate this pack. So, sadly, there's no way of following them through here. It's incredibly thick. Trust me, we know we've walked through here. And if Jamie does want to come back and lend a hand, she can head towards Hyena Road. Cheers, Ephraim. Goodbye, everyone. I'm going to drop. Okay, Ephraim's going to go the other way. We're going to go this way, and hopefully one of us will get lucky. But we are closer to the Buffalo's with cut line here, and basically if this is Central Road, which runs east-west, and this is Buffalo's with cut line, which runs east-west. west. The dogs are slightly closer to the buffalo's cut line, running in a directly easterly direction away from us, but they have been tending north. So I'm going to use that kind of intel from being with them earlier on to hopefully get us into the right spot. But it's a very big block, and no guarantees that we're going to get lucky. Sounds like there's something under the car here. I'm just going to have to jump and pull out maybe a branch from our off-roading. Shouldn't take me long though. Oh, here we go.
Yeah,
the magazine
is mobile, so
the east perfect jungle.
Into the hyena
road, no more video. I know. But I'm getting there. I wish you could be watching this. Oh, you can. Watch a little bit. There we go. That one didn't make it. Small price to pay though. Sorry about that little black monkey orange.
Driving around.
Okay, so that was Ephraim Yukaji on the radio, just giving a few updates about those wild dog. And Jamie has offered to possibly come into the area and give us a hand. And that will certainly increase our chances greatly of getting another view of them. Thanks to Robert, who's done some research just to clarify I wasn't talking absolute nonsense about the age of wild dogs and how long they usually live to in the wild. I said not much more than 10 to 12 years, and I'm told the maximum is around 11. So thanks, Robert. And interestingly, the average age is around 5 to 8 years old. So not a very long lifespan at all. Now the trick in these situations is, this is the riverbed that they drop down into. I mean, it doesn't look like anything too serious here, but they could follow this riverbed back up to where we are, or they could continue east. I mean, they could do one of a million things, but let's just carry on potting along this road slowly. Maybe, just maybe, they will poke their head out. What I'm thinking of doing is waiting up at the crest. That way we can look back as well as look forward down into the next valley. On the crest, and it's always deceptive how quickly these animals can move, so we need to just make sure we don't actually fall behind them. They move a lot quicker than we sometimes give them credit for when you're not actually with them. Raisa, and you are interested to know whether or not I got a glimpse of whether that individual that was getting bullied, that pup that was getting bullied, was a female, because Jamie has done a rough count and she thinks that there actually could be 9 males and 2 females within this pack, and you would kind of presume that the males would maybe team up on the slightly smaller females. It's a very good point, Raisa, but I sadly didn't get a good enough glimpse, and it will be interesting to see actually how many there are, because even though Jamie, she did mention that she kind of did a rough count and that's what she came up with, but she's not
100% sure. Either way, though, there's a strong kind of leaning towards male dominance within this pack of pups compared to females. Good point, and something that we should monitor closely. So thanks for that. I'm going to hop onto the hood of the vehicle here so I can stand up and get a better vantage point. And if anything happens, I'll be sure to shout and let you guys know. But for now, VM and I are going to be waiting here, and you are going to be going off to another animal that's got a similar bird's eye view to me at the moment.
I was on my way to helping Scott before I became very distracted by this particularly lovely gentleman. Just bear with me one moment. I just want to listen to the calls that are happening in the bush. I thought I heard alarm calls, so just hold on one sec. Nope, it's all gone very quiet again. Amazing how this gentleman has just appeared out of nowhere. It's a huge male giraffe, one of the biggest that I've seen out here. Incredibly dark in color, as you can see. Definitely a mature bull, I would say over 10 years old. I always find it fascinating to look at those legs and just think of how much weight they are actually capable of carrying and how fast they can move. I mean, they've got such a strange center of gravity with that long neck. I always wonder at the amount of coordination they must have. He's stretching right up there to get the best possible access to what look like bush willow leaves. You can see how the ossicones, since he was tilting his head so kindly, are completely rubbed bald, bald on top. So for new viewers, that's one of the best ways of identifying a male versus a female giraffe, are those horns or ossicones on the top of his head. He's even got bald patches around the bony protrusion at the back of those ossicones. Also probably rubbed smooth in a similar way as the top of the horns, which is by by fighting with other males. I'm chuckling at his... He's really determined to absolutely get to the top... The leaves as high up as possible.
Right now we're road.
Stretching up. I'm stopping to have a munch. For those of you who have been watching our safaris over the last few days, this is a different gentleman to the male that we've been watching courting that female over the last few days, the female with the calf. A different male, although he would definitely be considered a serious competition. In fact, I wouldn't be surprised if he's actually slightly bigger than that male. He's also being cryptic, hiding behind the trees. Hello, boy. Here you go. Thank you. Aren't you a gentleman? And just to let you know, I have checked all around Galago Shortcut and Galago Pan. No sign of any hyena. I'll pop back to the den later this evening and see if there's any sign of what was going on there, although I'm very happy that Scott has managed to relocate the wild dog that we lost count of, or that we didn't spot initially. Good to see. But I'll go by the hyena den anyway, just to see if there's any evidence of fighting between them and the wild dogs, just to finish off the story. Look at that. Awesome stuff. Turn around so that we can get a nicer view. Hey, Luca. Luca, you're watching again. That's fantastic news. So Luca is watching now, we know. Luca is watching in Romania. You'd like to know what the smallest animal that we have on the reserve is. And Luca, I'm going to take a guess and think and suggest that maybe you're meaning mammal, because obviously the smallest animal that we have would be something like a pepper tick, for example, tiny little insect, or something like a mite. But in terms of tiniest mammal species, we do get rodents, we get bushveld gerbils and elephant shrews. The smallest predator, oh sorry Luca, you did say smallest mammal. The smallest predator is something known as a dwarf mongoose that you might have seen on drive with Scott recently. I always keep an eye out for them, so I'll see if I spot them. What other smallest antelope is the Sharp's Graysbok. Tiny, tiny little antelope, similar to a Steenbok or a Dacre. And he's definitely not as relaxed, this giraffe, as the male that we've been watching over the last few weeks. That could also be because it's so windy. You can see how the wind, and probably hear how the wind is howling. What else is the smallest example? Smallest predator is the dwarf mongoose. Smallest little rodent is probably somewhere close to a little bush gerbil or a dormouse or an elephant shrew. Of course, at the moment, we're looking at a close-up of the nose of the tallest mammal. And the tallest mammal in the world, actually. Impressive height. The only other animal that can feed higher than he can is an elephant. And we did happen to encounter an entire herd of them drinking at Galago Pan. However, I left the sighting because there is one enormous bull who is very much in must. We smelt him before we saw him, actually. Hey, Andrew, he was pretty stinky. And must, for new viewers, is a state that male elephants go into where their testosterone levels heighten. They tend to spend a lot more time harassing females. And occasionally, oh, he's got a scratch on his nose, I think. Occasionally, they're a little bit more aggressive. Is that a scratch or was it just a leaf? He's not being very obliging. Look at that tongue. That tongue can extend over half a meter. Wonderful that you're all sending through some amazing screenshots. The one thing that this incredible camera has to offer is I think we've had some of our best close-up views of the animals. Watch the way his nostrils close when he gets close to thorns. I mean, that must be purely a reflex arc. There can't be much conscious thought involved. So an instant stimulus from the hairs around his nose and the whiskers around his nose respond immediately to contact by closing the nostrils so that he doesn't get thorns on the inside of that sensitive mucous membrane. I've never really noticed that before. It just goes to show with this incredible camera what incredible views this camera can bring us. That, of course, is provided the giraffe doesn't stick its head behind the thickest tree it can find, as our gentleman has done. I've often spoken about the wind unsettling animals. That's why he is so nervous, and that's also why I left the elephant herd. There's very dense vegetation, which is also windy, and they've probably just had an encounter with those wild dogs over the last 2 hours or so, which never puts elephants in a good mood. So the combination of all of those factors and the fact that I couldn't really have an escape route and that I just decided it was time. There was no aggression from them, but there were three big bulls, one very much in must and a little bit aggressive towards each other. It was just time for us to go. Hey boy, you're being thoroughly unobliging. Yes. I'm sure that he is reveling in the cooler temperatures, as I've said about all of the animals at the moment. And Jeannie, you were wondering how much rain we had yesterday. Jeannie, I'm not entirely sure. I'd have to hazard a guess. We didn't have all that much yesterday afternoon, and this morning, I would say, or for the whole of today, it's been a very light drizzle. I'm not sure how hard it rained first thing this morning, but I would put it somewhere at around between 5 and 8 milliliters, maybe, millimeters. That's a sort of a rough guess. I have to confess, up until the phone call about the nyala, I was not awake this morning. I was doing a very good job of sleeping in. I'll double check and see if we can get a rough estimate. I haven't noticed any major puddles in the road, which suggests to me, although the earth has been very thirsty, it just suggests to me that it wasn't actually as much as it seemed. We really need a couple of very drizzly days to help us out of this drought. Let's see if maybe we can get a nice view of him. No. go backwards and forwards to try and find a clear view of this giraffe. Oopsie. And just a reminder that obviously we're not, because of the impact of the drought and the effect that it's had on the vegetation, that the fact that there's no grass growing around where there should be grass, thankfully it's been very convenient. Just a reminder that we are not, as a Wild Earth policy, not driving off-road to view anything except things like wild dogs, leopards, lions, anything high profile. For the general game, and even with things like elephants or buffalo, we're trying to keep our off-roading down to an absolute minimum so that we don't negatively impact the environment in any way. It's amazing how he's targeting the thorniest trees. I love watching the way that giraffe eat, the level of dexterity of their lips and their tongue, and now being able to watch the way that their nostrils close up, which I've never noticed before today. I guess it absolutely makes sense. Every time it gets close, his head gets close to the thorns, they immediately snap shut, as I was chatting about earlier, but now we can see it really clearly. How interesting. And of course, those long eyelashes as well also serve to protect the eyes, make sure that he doesn't get any kind of injury from thorns. Beautifully adapted. The bush veld fights back out here, and most of the trees have some kind of thorn, just like the one he disappeared behind. And I've had a couple of guests remark upon the fact that everything seems to have thorns or spikes. Not everything does, but it does mean that the animals out here adapted to eating them have to be adapted to get around the thorns. And the fascinating thing about that as well is that the trees are actually what's going to keep these animals going during the drought. So as I said, when I discussed the no off-roading rule, there's absolutely no grass layer or hardly any grass layer. And it's really the trees that have the roots tapping down into the underwater water supplies, and that have some capability for nutrient storage. They're really the things that keep the animals alive out here. And I think it's time for us to leave our gentleman giraffe. He doesn't want to be on camera this afternoon. But don't forget, if you have any questions about what you're seeing or anything in general about the bush veld, don't forget to send them through to us on hashtag SafariLIVE on Twitter, or you can email them through to questions@wildearth.tv. And as I said at the start of the show, we really love to hear from you. And if you're a new viewer, don't be shy, let us know. And tell all your friends about the amazing things that you could see on a live safari. And just an example of one such question. Daniel, you were wondering about where the best place is to do your Fugaza level 1. That is, for those of you unfamiliar, that is sort of the first step in becoming a guide. It is the Field Guide Association of South Africa. And within that qualification comes a governmental qualification as well. I couldn't possibly say where the best place is. There are so many wonderful, wonderful training organizations that you could go to. There's also all kinds of courses offered by lodges that will help to train you up to become a guide. And we've all taken very, very different approaches, all of the different presenters, in the way that we went about our training. We've all got very different backstories. I trained at an organization very, very close to Hoedspruit, so not too far from where we are now. You'll find that everybody has a different answer to that question, but I will tell you that Fugaza has an extended list of training providers on their website. It just depends on where it is in the country as well that you would like to go and work. I'm just going to see if I can catch up with this herd of elephants in a more open patch. See if we can see anything. That is, of course, unless Scott would like some help with those wild dogs. And I might just get hold of him on the Game Drive channel to find out. And since I'd like to find out what Scott's been up to, actually let's go over there so that he can show you a hornbill's nest that he's found.
So still no luck finding the wild dog, sadly. We are alone now. Ephraim's moved out of the area. And it's going to be a complete gamble as to whether we find them again. There's so much thick areas in this northeastern corner, so I'm not too sure whether to suggest Jamie to come or not. I guess she'll be able to decide whether she's feeling lucky or not. Now, what we have found is a nest. Inside this dark hole are some hornbills. And at this stage of the year, I'm guessing it's just the chicks that are left in the nest. The cavity appears very large leading into that hole. The entrance appears quite large to that cavity. But what you'll find is that the entrance will be just about as wide as a coin slot, because they would have built it up with mud and excrements. Once the female has been in there for about, I think it's about 15 days to 20 days after the eggs have hatched, and she's needed to tend to them for those initial 15 to 20 days, then she will fly out of the nest. She'll break out of that little coin slot. This is all after having done a full feather molt, so she's had a full makeover whilst in there. And then she breaks out, and then the chicks as well as her will rebuild that coin slot. And the reason for that is that obviously the growing chicks will need more food, and both the mother and the father will need to feed them. Sadly, they've stopped making a noise. They were chattering wildly as we drove past earlier, and I'm not sure if they knew the adult was returning, but we actually did see the adult fly, drop off an insect, and then fly off again. I'm planning maybe on actually waiting here and doing a bit of a stakeout, and I don't know how long it's going to take before the adult returns. Hopefully not too long. Usually it doesn't take too long. I mean, they've got a big job at hand. They've obviously got to feed themselves, and there could be as many as three chicks. That's the usual brood. Oh, what's VM spotted?
Bustard.
Something else?
There is a bustard.
Oh, VM spotted a bustard. Shit, how on earth did you spot that? VM's got very good eyes, you'll learn the longer you spend with us, and he's often the one to spot these incredibly difficult sights. Now, you'll see a small little bird in there, and it looks like it could be a red-crested corhan doing some grooming. Vian mentioned that it could be a bustard. Very similar looking birds, the bustards and the corhans. And it looks to be a female to me. When I saw Vian pan the camera across to the side, I thought he had seen the hornbill on its way back in. And what I'm going to do is just get off my book to show you the corhans and the bustards, because you didn't get the best view there. Okay. So here's the red-crested corhan, and that's who I think it is. I haven't got a good view. I think it could be the female, the male. I mean, it could even be a male, because we didn't see the chest very well. You need to see the chest of the male. I didn't see a little red crest either, though, so maybe more likely a female than a male. And below is the black-bellied bustard. Again, very similar-looking bird. Well, very happy to hear that Tara, one of our new viewers, has just discovered the show this week in Ireland, and she said it's made her year so far, and she's actually going to be coming to Salati and Kirongwe for some eco-training courses. Eco-training is a facility that helps people who want to become guides get the necessary qualifications, and you're in for a great time, Tara. I've been to Salati before. It's a beautiful area, so that I can assure you. I haven't been lucky enough to go to Kirongwe yet, but I've heard great things about it, and eco-training is a wonderful training facility where I'm sure you'll get some great mentors and some great tuition
to get you started in your guiding career. So exciting stuff. And the great thing is you can start brushing up on all of your birds and tricks of the trade by following us on Safari. And if you do, you're going to be leaps and bounds ahead of most of the other students. So good luck for everything. And I'm looking forward to spending a lot more time on Safari with you until you get to Karangwe and Salati in, I think it's September, you said you're going to be starting. So still lots of time to practice. In June, not September. So sooner than that, which is good for you. It would have been a long wait if it was September, so I'm happy that it's not that long. And Jamie is going to take over from me now. We're going to wait here and do a stakeout for this hornbill. So if you needed to rush across all of a sudden, Jamie will give the cue, and then before you know it, you will be back here, hopefully getting to see the hornbill feed the chicks within that little cavity. Wish us luck. Hopefully it won't take too long, and we'll see you later.
Well, I'll be ready to send you across to Scott as quickly as possible if those adults do make an appearance. But just quickly to chat a bit about, or chat to Tara, who's watching in Ireland. Tara, you've mentioned that you're coming across to Salati and to Karangwe, which is really exciting news. And just to let you know, I lived on Makalali for the last 3 years or so before I started working at WildEarth 6 months ago. So I lived there for about 2.5 years. And that is right next door. It's on the other side of the road from Karangwe. I know that area incredibly well. I also know most of the guides and the people that you will encounter there. Some lovely, lovely people. And I wish you all the best. Have a fantastic time. I also know that Karangwe and Makalali, they've had a little bit more rain than we have had. So you should be seeing things a little bit greener and some of the dams with a bit more water than we've seen here. Awesome news though. Good luck, Tara. I wish you all of the best. I'm glad to hear that you've discovered Safari Live. Maybe you'll go across to your training program with a slight advantage. Who knows? Natalie are watching. They are regular viewers, and apparently Natalie and Fada met on their eco training course in the Savi Sands a while ago, and it's actually coming up to their reunion time. Isn't it amazing how the bush actually has the power to bring people together? And I certainly think that that effect is amplified in terms of the reach of these live safaris. It's a way for people not only to connect with the bush and with us, but also with other people who share such similar interests. I know that a lot of friendships have been formed. Aww, that's unfortunate. The wind's blowing. I've been catching my hat all day. That's the first time I haven't caught it, and it's because I'm busy chatting. So busy chatting to you guys, I wasn't paying attention. Apparently my hair was, despite the fact that I have the longest hair, wasn't enough to keep that hat on my head. I don't know why I'm wearing it though, because it's not exactly like the sun is beating down on us anyway. It was more for a shelter for my eyes for the rain, but it stopped raining anyway. We've actually taped. It's gloomy, skies are heavy. We've actually taped this cover down to stop it from blowing away, because when we started the checks on the drive, it flew out and I performed the most spectacular one-handed catch imaginable, which I'm really quite disappointed wasn't caught on live camera. I don't understand how I could fall over but not do something incredibly coordinated. Just to continue our chat about training and becoming a field guide, and I'm always hugely encouraging for people to come and join us. And David, you want to know how what the likelihood is of a person getting a visa for some kind of work or residence permit within South Africa. And David is coming from the UK. David, my best friend, my absolute closest friend in the entire world, Emma, that the viewers will be familiar with, is from the UK. I think, let me just zoom to the top of the hill. Here we go. Sorry, I completely forgot about the dip in signal that always happens through the Mawati drainage. I was in the middle of answering David's question, and I was saying that one of my best friends, or actually my closest friend, is a guide who is originally from Swindon in the UK. Here's some baby Franklin here I want to show you. Hopefully, sorry Andrew, I've been on a terrible slope, but that's where the Franklin seemed to want to be spotted. Where'd they go? There's an adult crested Franklin. There's mommy and there's daddy. I swear I saw a baby Franklin. I promise I saw a baby Franklin. Oh, there we go. Here we are. Hello, little one. Perfect little miniature, but about half the size. We've spoken before about... Sorry, David, I promise I will get back to your question in a moment. Let me just finish up with these little Franklin while we can still see them. Spoken before about altricial and precocial birds. So Franklin is a really good example of a precocial bird. So when these chicks hatch, they're already pretty much fully fledged. They almost look like little miniatures of the adults, although they're a bit fluffy still. And they are born ready to walk and wander around. They've got their eyes open, their senses are fully formed. Whereas something, for example, like the hornbills, that I know Scott is sitting at the nest right now, or even a dove or a pigeon, those chicks are altricial. So they're underdeveloped when they first hatch into the world. They're missing feathers, they're all pink and sort of... I wouldn't say those sorts of baby birds are the cutest things in the world. They're a bit alien looking. But you sort of know what I mean, with their eyes still shut and still lacking in any kind of feathery covering. But that's why I just wanted to stop quickly, because already I think our little fledgling... Oh, the hornbills have arrived.
Okay, VM, I've just spotted it. It's straight ahead of us now. So we've been staying on the cavity because they fly so quickly. There it is hopping along. And it's got a kill in its beak. It's a yellow-billed hornbill. You can see the little bug there. And VM's just doing a good job staying wide because it could fly in very quickly at any moment. I think it's a little bit skeptical of our presence. And that's why it's taking a little bit of a longer route to get to this cavity in the tree. Come on, I promise you, we won't tell anyone nasty that you've got babies in there. All we want to do is see you fly in and feed them. Huh. What I want to maybe do is just reverse ever so slightly in the hope that it'll feel a little bit safer if we're slightly further away. We may not get the best view, but at least that way we're not going to interfere too much with it. So let's wait here. You can still kind of see the cavity from there. Okay, let me move forward slightly. There we go. So that's better. There we go. It's come closer. Here we go. Listen to the babies calling. Just like that. It's done. And off it goes. Yay. I'm going to drive a little bit closer because last time the chicks also continued to yabber away for quite some time. Obviously they compete quite ferociously with one another. Hang on, listen carefully. So I'm sure you can hear them chirping away. Obviously,
where are you?
They're going to be...
quite upset with whichever one of the lucky and all likelihood three chicks got that morsel, and it'll be probably one of them is going to be slightly, ever so slightly larger than the others from out-competing its siblings. But wonderful to know that there's a happy family and next generation of yellow-billed hornbills being raised in the cavity of this wonderful marula tree. Some of you may actually remember, probably in December, I was driving along this road and noticed some hornbills investigating this cavity, and I said we were going to keep a close eye on it. We didn't, or at least I didn't, because this is the next time I've been back to check. But there's lots going on here. We can't check everywhere. Oh, look at this. What next? Jamie and Andrew. There we go. And they've come to help us look for the wild dogs. And what I'm going to suggest to Jamie is that she continues in the direction she's going. That would make sense. And we can carry on in the direction we're going. Oh, she's going to take Vulture's Nest. And let's see, she's going to maybe wait here for a quick chat. Andrew loves being behind the camera. So literally hiding behind the camera. Hello, Andrew. Hello, Jamil. Nice to see you guys. You can see Andrew sporting his new hat from that he got on holiday, Zimbabwe. Very nice, Andrew.
Thank you.
And we're going to carry on now. Jamie, I don't know if you want to go up to wherever you want to go. I'm going to do Hyena Road and maybe back to the dam, but wherever you're feeling lucky.
Awesome. Okay, I'll do a bit of a loop up back that way.
Sounds good. Well, we're going to send you over onto Jamie's vehicle, so hop across and we will see you a little bit later.
From one view to the other.
My car won't start.
Oh, no.
My mobilizer's not working.
Oh, no, Scotty.
I think we have to power down.
You couldn't have jumped across to the vehicle at a better time because you've left us broken down and stranded, but carry on and hopefully...
Okay,
you know what it is? It's your...
Yeah, it's our signal.
It's our signal.
Interfering with us.
It's our signal.
It's their fault that our car won't start.
So, Andrew, should we sit here for a while? Should
That's
we?
That's where the problem's coming from.
We'll move away for you. The wondrous effects of Rusty's broadcast signal. It acts as the world's biggest jammer. I hope Scott does manage to actually leave. Oh well, we'll soon find out. Ah, he's managed to start. Well done, Andrew. That was entirely accidental. I was desperately trying to get James for days before he went on leave, and then I accidentally sabotaged poor old Scott. Where was I? David's question. Right, sorry, David, you had to wait a little bit for your answer. Now, you were watching in the UK, and I said to you that one of my closest friends is from Swindon, and she works now as a guide in this country. David, I'm not going to lie to you and say that it's an easy process, because it's actually not. But I do know several people who have gone through it, they've jumped through all the hoops, much in the same way that any country has to jump through it, or any visitor that wants a more permanent visa has to jump through hoops in any country. I've been through it with my student visa for the UK. I know of several people around the world who, it's one of those things where you just have to try it. And so I'm not going to lie and say that it's the easiest process in the world, but it is entirely doable. And there are people that I know that have done it. I've got a very close friend who is in Germany. I know that I have a close friend in Switzerland who is looking at doing the same thing. So it's entirely possible, but it's not a short process. And it's not one that can be done overnight. It requires, as with or anything in that particular regard, plenty of ticking boxes and doing the various paperwork that you just have to lump and go through. It's doable. I have a very, very close friend as well from the Netherlands who recently got her permanent residency and then citizenship. That, though, was a slightly different case because she actually got married to a South African and had a child. That made it slightly easier. Always a bit of a process. How fascinating. exciting is that? That's actually wonderful news. Still on the subject of people training to be guides and how they came to be out here, or if they're going to choose to come out here. And Hada apparently would never have done the eco training course without having discovered the WildEarth cameras. And she's actually saying a big thank you to WildEarth for essentially changing her life. And that to me is one of the most special aspects about these drives. How incredible is it that all the live cameras, that we can foster a love in some people that is so fierce that they're actually able, and of course they're able to, come out and explore this incredible world in person. And even if they're not, it's still a fantastic opportunity to really view stories, I think, in the best way possible. We've just become so intimately familiar with the and plants and the various roads around here. And speaking of it, I was trying to... One of our viewers asked me on the last drive I did why she hasn't seen any wax balls.
Sorry, I was on my phone.
You're on a testicular. That's cool. I can't actually find the wax ball. Andrew's managed to catch a little rattling testicular on camera, very briefly, which that in itself is an absolute achievement. They don't really sit around and behave. There is a blue wax ball. It is. Or is that the testicular again? They're hiding in the buffalo thorn. They're making my life difficult. I spotted a blue wax ball, but I'm not sure where it's gone. I think it might have been Fiona that asked me about the wax balls yesterday afternoon. Oh well, we have at least half the answer to the question as to why we don't see wax balls. Because they don't sit still, so we could show them to you. So hoping to be able to give you a nice view of the wax balls, especially with that super zoom. Oh well, next wax ball sighting, we'll get them. We'll get them on camera.
I've never put a wax ball on camera.
Really? Andrew says he's never managed. Right. Well, now we have a mission. We need to get one of those little feeding parties on the ground where they stick around for a while. Okay, Andrew, it's our new mission. That being said, they have been notably absent, as have the various cuckoo species and some of the weavers. Not completely absent, there's still some of them here. And I spoke to Emma about it, who works at Makalali, by the way, to continue with that conversation. I spoke to her about it. I tried to ask, and she actually said they've seen a noted increase in some of the bird species, and probably because they've had a little bit more rain. And birds, of course, completely unrestricted by any kind of fencing, can go exactly where they'd like to. But I'm sure that's why we haven't managed any cuckoo species either. Even that crested barbet isn't going to be obliging. It's going to hide. Oh! Ooh, here's one for the camera. Please stay. Be distracted. Must be distracted. Awesome. Birchall's cuckoo, everybody. And Raisa, this is the bird. And Raisa, I know you are watching. This is the bird that you suggested might be the one that we found the kill for. And Raisa, looking at it now, I would not be at all surprised. The only problem is I didn't find any brown feathers, but that doesn't mean, you know, it could be that the animal that killed it, it could be that the animal that killed it only plucked certain feathers. Because if you look, we found this... Sorry, to update other viewers, we found this kill site where a bird had clearly been killed and its feathers plucked out. And we were trying to figure out what it might be and what might have killed it. And it had long black feathers, so something quite large. I suspected bird of prey, but I could well be wrong. And if I go forward a little bit, because it did have dappled feathers, which you can't see on the cuckoo in in that view that we've had, but it does have them under the back of its tail. Zip it in your top right corner, Andrew. Now it's in the top middle. There you go. Well done. Well, as you can see, really clearly, it has dappled feathers under its tail. I'm afraid you'll just have to take my word for it there. It was a fascinating discovery. Awesome news. Scott has relocated the wild dog pack for you.
Yay! Vim and I were just discussing all the various options as to where these animals may be, and here they are at Buffalo's Hook Dam. And I'm just gonna creep forward. I think there's some more members of the pack further up ahead. And who knows when they snuck past us or whether they were in front of us or behind us, but absolutely massive fortune to have stumbled across them again. And getting that strong, pungent odor of wild dog again that we spoke of earlier. Let me reposition again. This isn't the best spot, and I think the rest of these pups, these are all the pups we're with now, are going to come and join the adults, which are just ahead of us. And it looks like the adults are going to come and join the pups. There comes one running past us here. So that was the missing male initially, I believe. That one did have big chunks out of its ear, as does, who was the one that was missing initially? Now this, I think, I don't know, let me know what you guys think. I think this one might have been the one that was missing. The other one with the very big notches out of its ear was the one that we were with. And I guess maybe the fact that he's leading up ahead means that he could be the alpha male. Here comes the female. They just move so effortlessly. And we're gonna have to turn around now. They're heading back north up Buffalo's East Road, slowly, towards our northern boundary. So it may only be a few more minutes that we're with them. But again, a huge, huge bonus that we're managing to spend a little bit more time with them as they go. Just going to stop and allow VM to film them as they run off, as it's a bit tricky when we're moving along this bumpy road. To Chris in Oregon, and you'd like to know if wild dogs mate for life. No, I don't think that is the case. The alpha male and alpha female will be kind of, what's the word, they will be faithful to one another, I guess, for the time that they are both the alphas, but they may well be overthrown by a new male or a new female or an up-and-coming female, and then the alpha male will continue to mate with alpha female and vice versa. So there will definitely be changes in hierarchy, and I think the alpha male will also be the one who mates with the beta female when conditions allow for that. So that's another thing that's important to remember, that also the secondary female will sometimes be allowed to mate, and who knows, possibly occasionally even the third in charge or the third female will be able to mate. Let's take a look here at this one on the right. Oh, it's just stopped. It was digging through a pile of elephant dung. And let's see if it doesn't do it with that next pile of dung, no. But the interesting thing with wild dogs is they actually like eating beetles, dung beetles, that bury themselves down into the ground below dung. And it's not something you see very often, but they
They really do enjoy crunching through beetles. I've only seen it a handful of times, and I think I just heard that one crunching through a beetle. And they'll often dig through various kinds of middens, piles of vegetable matter, where herbivores will defecate to leave kind of a message center, an information center. Stop temporarily, just trying to work out what the best plan of attack is for what will be in all likelihood our last few moments with them. They are steadily approaching the northern boundary, which we are on. Everything to our left is going to be an area where we cannot go. You can see them through here, so let's just wait and see what they do. Not easy, and I've parked on it. Tricky angle for VM. Let's just wait here. You can see a glimpse of one through there. Okay, let me reposition. Sorry, VM. Looks like it'll be better for us to get onto a firebreak that runs parallel to the northern boundary here. Efrem, I'm not sure if you got the update, but the crack on our mobile east, or roughness of east along the firebreak. And maybe, VM, we might be able to even film them through the bushes here. It's a bit of a gamble, and we don't want to get you guys seasick, but...